I would like to introduce the first panel. It's going to be tomorrow and the day after. And this debate will set the stage about what the future, and especially the future enabled by technology, might have in store for us. Well, what do we mean by the future? Well, that's hard to say, as we currently struggle to predict what the next couple of years have in store for us. But let's think about the extreme for a second. Let's think about as far out as we can. Existentialrisk.org, for example, estimates that if technology would allow us to colonize the future accessible universe and allows our minds to be implemented in computational hardware, there's the potential of 10 to the power of 54 human brain emulation subjective life years in the future. Well, that's a one with 54 zeros. It's a lot of potential life and a lot of potential value. And of course, these numbers can be debated. But it should only serve as an eye-opener of how far out we might think and how much impact our actions and technological inventions might have in the future. But let's start in the present, and let's see what's down the line. The voting will be up in a second. Please vote and share your thoughts on Twitter at Foresight Inst. And please now help me welcome the panel, Bryan Bethencourt, Julia Bossmann, Bryan Johnson, Nichol Bradford, Richard Titus, and our moderator, Jim Norris.
All right, nice and cozy. I think everyone can hear us, right? Beautiful. So, my name is James Norris, and I have the privilege of helping these interesting folks communicate what they've learned and what they're thinking about the future. Our panel is tomorrow and the day after, as Julia just mentioned. This is pretty broad, and we're actually hoping to dive into some interesting, creative topics. And we want your interaction, so I encourage you to shout out comments or questions as you think appropriate. Keep in mind that we're here to hear from the individuals here, but I do want some interaction, and we're going to look for those questions near the end. But I'll go ahead and start just with framing with our amazing panel. Kick off with Ryan on the far left. So Ryan Bethencourt is a biotech entrepreneur, investor, and one of the founders of the biohacking movement. So currently he's at IndieBio. He's a program director and venture partner, and basically has invested in over 56 different biotech startups. He's pioneering this space. One fun fact for him, I'm trying to get some trivia so you know more about who they are as humans. He's a pro-GMO vegan, so you can ask about that if you're interested. All right, and next up we have Julia Bossmann. So she is a president of Foresight Institute. Before, she founded Synthetic, Anticipate 8 Analytics, and quite a few other companies and organizations. She's one of the leaders in Foresight overall. So one of her fun facts is that she actually was one of the few people that called Trump's win. And I think made a pretty penny from it.
You didn't say celebrate.
We didn't say celebrate, but I'm neutral in this case. So Nichol is a friend.
I phoned back for Hillary, but
how much money did you win?
Not enough to make the pen go away.
Next up we have Nichol Bradford. She is the CEO of Willow Group, which publishes this amazing course called Finder's Course, which helps with radical transformation. It's quite a unique program. She's also the executive director at the Transformative Technology Lab at Sophia University, and is one of the pioneers of transformative tech. So her fun fact is, just found out, she wrote a novel about badass women by night and vigilantes badass women by day and vigilantes by night. It's called The Sisterhood. Pretty interesting. I think I shall take a read. Okay, Richard is an interesting character. He's a serial entrepreneur, executive, recently at Samsung. He's been pioneering so many different things, it's hard to really capture it, but you probably know him from Razorfish. So that's probably the most interesting one. And he also called Trump's win. So we have two out of four or five. We'll see how the rest of the folks did. But finally, we have Bryan Johnson. So he is the founder of Kernel, OS Fund, and Braintree. Quite a few companies you've probably heard of or use. So he built Kernel in 2016 to be the world's first neuroprosthetics company to enhance human intelligence. And one of the many interesting things about him, besides being a mountaineer, climbing volcanoes, and so on, is he recently wrote a children's book called Code 7. Also interesting to look at. But that's our panel today. I want you all to consider yourself part of this too, so you're also involved. But I think with that, we're going to jump in. This is not a formal debate. This is a casual kind of conversation between thought leaders. And the questions came from some of the organizers, some of the audience, and basically it's just trying to get us thinking about the future. So let's start with imagining it's 2030, and you're looking back on today. What do you think will be humanity's biggest surprise between now and then? What will surprise us? Anyone could take it.
But most of us are still alive. I'll give it a little color. So, you know, this right now, this month, is the hottest month on record in the Arctic Circle, which is kind of catastrophically bad for so many reasons I can't even count. And at the same time, we've all sort of taken the collective red pill and elected a man who's denying the rate of climate change. And so I think in 2030, the most amazing thing would be that we're all still alive, because it means that the fabric of society hasn't really collapsed yet.
And that's how this debate will go.
I'll go next. I think that in 2030, when we're all looking back, one of the things that will surprise us the most or inspire us the most is that we actually did have a worldwide awakening. And I think that what I hope will happen from this period of time, and then also just what I'm seeing with most of the people I know who have meditation sites, their traffic has gone crazy, where people are wanting to up-level their skill sets. And so I think between that and, you know, people like Richard, he actually does quite a lot of work in making sure that we all are alive. I think that we will have a worldwide awakening. And so that's what I think we'll look back and be surprised and inspired by.
Yeah, I agree with Richard's worry, actually, about whether what humanity will be like in 2030. And I think as we build more technology and if we succeed with it, there will also be different questions asked in 2030 of what it means to be human and how we relate to machines. So one thing, for example, that I would expect by 2030 is that we have fully conversational artificial intelligence. So you could talk to someone on the internet and they could even have a human-sounding voice and you could know whether you're actually talking to a human being or to a machine. And on the other hand, even we ourselves would get closer to machines. So the line between what's a biologically born human and what's a machine that has similar or same capabilities or exceeds in capabilities will be blurred by that time, and it will be very interesting how we deal with that.
So I want to talk about the wet side of the world. So I actually think we're going to see, by 2030, I actually think we're going to see a revolution in molecular manufacturing, so actually brought on by biotechnology. And so we have that today. Many of the, you know, if you eat cheese, you eat a product of molecular biology. It's a GMO rennet that's made an enzyme that's actually fermented. Instead of coming out of a cow's gut, it actually comes out of a bacteria. The vitamins we eat are almost all made in massive bioreactors in the middle of cornfields and sugarcane fields today. And what we're seeing at IndieBio is we're seeing an entirely new way of seeing molecular manufacturing. So to make a pound of something, carbon, something with carbon, it's about between 15 to 30 cents per pound of sugar. So that conversion rate basically heralds the rise of molecular manufacturing, and that's coming like today. That's stuff we're doing in the lab today, which means rollout by 2030, it'll be everywhere. And the consequences of that, I don't think we fully thought that through, but what that basically means is we're starting to talk to huge companies like Nestle, companies that serve billions of people, and it's you can profitably feed people, as an example, for under a dollar or two per day, profitably, right? That's technology that exists now, and by 2030, it'll be fully rolled out globally.
So I just want to jump in because I took the question in a different way than a specific prediction, and so I just want to say what I predict. So what I'm working on is transformative technology. That's tech for mental and emotional well-being. So I think that all of the areas of technology, whether it's molecular manufacturing or AI or whatever it is, neuroscience, like whatever it is, we will have applications that we design specifically for supporting human mental and emotional well-being. So your AI will be your AI friend. You know, you'll take supplements specifically for mood that are not necessarily drugs, but are food related. And so everything that everyone's working on fits into transformative technology. There will be an application for that by 2030.
And so one thing I do when I talk to entrepreneurs to assess what I'm going to invest is I analyze whether I consider them to be future literate. Not something I consider myself an expert at this, but basically I define it as people who create mental models for the future while living experimentally and adventurously. And so this question he posed basically allowed each person to frame their mental models on the world. And so if you contemplate the mental models we have, like right now we think of these big chunks like climate science and AI and biology, the programmability of it, and genetics. There are these big chunks of things that we understand the world through. I think the one thing that is missing is human intelligence, how the age of neuroscience and the ability to work with our neural code is not incorporated in our mental models. And in the expression, no one really is speaking about this. It's like this blind spot we have, and of course, it's on the periphery, it lives in sci-fi, and a few movies have talked about it. But I think that we will get to a point where we'll be able to work with our neural code, both reading and writing, in the same way we've worked with biology and genetics, and same complex biological systems. And I think that it will create a more consequential outcome than any of us anticipate in a faster time frame than I think we would anticipate. And so I think that the models we maintain will define how we understand ourselves in the future, and they define what we choose to work on and why we work on those things, which I think is the value of having this conversation instead of drilling in specific verticals that we are all very familiar with and repeating arguments that may are well-worn.
So I have a question for that. So is your sense that we are restrained by the limits of human intelligence and emotional intelligence, well, all the kinds of intelligence, emotional intelligence, intellectual intelligence, mathematical intelligence, all these things? Or is your view that we're going to expand and extend those intelligences using technology, learning, or new drugs, or technology?
So there's certainly an intelligence scale of biological species. And we, humans, we reign supreme on Earth today because we are the most intelligent species. So we decide who we eat, who we neuter, who we allow to go extinct, who we save. So if I eat a hamburger, I don't have to hate a cow to eat the burger, right? I choose to eat the burger because that's just that animal's in service of me. And so I think that intelligence is the most powerful and precious resource in existence. And as it amplifies, it, of course, has greater power and authority over ruling of all other resources. So I think that whether you're talking about human intelligence or artificial intelligence, these manifestations of intelligence will be basically the source of all power going forward on planet Earth and elsewhere in the universe.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that intelligence is the most powerful tool and resource that we have. And it greatly depends on how this is going to be used in what future we're moving towards. So we can think of, you know, very positive uses for it where we can cure diseases and figure out the most complex and difficult problems in the world with the use of intelligence, whether it's artificial intelligence or human amplified intelligence. And we can also see very bad developments. So, for example, a regime that wants to oppress people and have alerts whenever there's speech against it will have an incredibly easy time doing this using artificial intelligence, natural language processing, and monitoring communications. So we are now at this waypoint in history where we need to be very careful and put a lot of guidance into how these technologies are developed and how they are deployed to make sure that, you know, it's going all towards a future that is beneficial for everyone on the planet.
And one thing to add, I don't know if many of you saw it, but or if you're familiar with Rosalind Picard's lab at MIT, and there's a scientist there named Ming-Zer Po, who's just been able to pick up sort of early reads on emotional state from Wi-Fi. So it's not only just what you write, it's how you feel.
I think actually one of the things I was curious about is we use the word intelligence in a very generic sense, but actually there's lots of different kinds of intelligence. And one of the things that I think is amazing about technology, so I suffer from both ADHD and dyslexia, and 100 years ago I would have been a farm worker because there was no technology to allow me to learn at the rate that technology has enabled me to learn and to adapt and to be able to work in a society today. And so I'm very excited and optimistic about that in terms of enhancements and human augmented intelligence. I have a very dystopian view of artificial intelligence because I think what Facebook and fake news has taught us in this election cycle is that artificial intelligence, by its very nature, is pathological. Mm. And so I think that we need to really think about how we keep our humanity within our technology as we evolve it over time.
I disagree with that. I don't think artificial intelligence by its very nature is pathological. I think they are pathological applications of artificial intelligence, and it is too easy in many ways to have it go in bad ways. But I also see extremely positive applications of artificial intelligence. One I just mentioned, which is artificial intelligence for science. And I was just at a meeting with the World Economic Forum at the Future Agenda Council, where we talked a lot about the future of artificial intelligence and robotics. And one thing that came up there was by 2030, if we want to use this number again, we want to see an artificial scientist win a Nobel Prize for solving a scientific problem such as curing cancer or other things that are too complex for any human mind to figure out.
Julie, just on that, it's already started. So we're starting to see algorithms. We saw one that actually figured out a pathway in planarium. For those of you that aren't familiar with planarium, those are the worms that you can cut up and they like regrow themselves. Like you can cut off the head and they grow a tail. You cut off their tail, they grow a head. Right? So it was actually very difficult to figure out how they do that regeneration. And an algorithm figured that out. I'll call it machine learning because I don't think it's artificial intelligence, but a machine figured that out.
Yeah, and we have artificial scientists who can run a robotic lab and form their own hypotheses, run their own bio experiments, read the results, and then form new hypotheses. So we're already at that point where we can radically accelerate scientific progress with the help of automation and AI.
So I'd also say on that point that, the frame we have is artificial intelligence is the frame we think through. And that we say, will it be able to discover something outside of the human? But I think that the proper mean of describing the future of humanity is HI plus AI. It's human intelligence plus artificial intelligence. And while we have low IO between us and our devices today via our thumbs and speech, I think that as we increase that IO capacity, that line will blur. But I think, again, that the thinking is critical because how we speak about this and imagine it will be the things we build, will determine the things we build. So we'll create mental models prior to building actual products. But I do think that as neuroscience and HI come online, that it will help change us. So these questions we pose in a different fashion, we'll think about it in a different way.
So what you're saying then is that if we imagine the future where we're actually looking for that that symbiotic relationship and we design towards that, then we increase the likelihood of having that relationship. Is that what you're saying?
That's right. I'm saying the frame that dominates our discussion today as basically being a sole AI frame is not an appropriate encapsulation of how intelligence will evolve over the coming decades. And I think that, it changes. So when people in this room decide what they're going to build and how they're going to build it, how they understand the future will be determined on how we speak about it and how we understand that.
I agree with that. One of the pieces of data that I think about a lot is an estimation that the World Health Organization has that by 2030, the leading disease burden will be depression. Worldwide. And so right now, if you look at the number of people who are trained mental health practitioners, it is not possible to close that gap. There are not enough schools, there are not enough years, it would take hundreds of years to close the gap in terms of being able to train enough people. And so the only way we do that is we have to start accessing technology and potentially AI to support us mentally and emotionally. And in order to do that well, we have to think about the framework that you've described where we don't see it as this and that, but how do the two things work together? Because there's some people that are so resistant to the idea of having artificial intelligence or avatars support support people who are in need. I think that turned everything off.
Yeah. do it.
Our tech is rising up against us.
For some people, you can get the feeling that it's hard to keep up anymore with all the things that are coming out. We're seeing this in other fields too. So nanotechnology, for example, was a very slow development over the past decades, but now recently it has picked up. We have seen the Nobel Prize for molecular machines. We now have functional models for modeling interaction on the molecular level. And if we combine this with artificial intelligence, we can also expect breakthroughs in those fields. So when I think about the far future of humanity or the amazing things that we consider science fiction, such as that we can, you know, augment our own brains with the help of technology, or that we can connect to machines with neural interfaces, that we, you know, all kinds of things that we imagine to be science fiction now, I think we may be seeing those within our lifetimes and within 2030.
So I just yesterday, oddly, was a judge for the LA Auto Show for the design award. They do an annual design award for, and the challenge was design the car for 2050, which was a really interesting thing. I said, all right, well, what did cars look like 50 years ago? Because that's really the right way to look at this thing. So if you look at that, actually, it made me really realize that evolution and innovation are not linear curves, right? They're very jagged. And so if you think about parts of our technology have come light years in 50 years, but actually the automobile, other than electric cars, which if anyone knows who I am, they know I have a vested interest in that. Other than sort of electricity, sort of bringing that technology back from the 1920s, cars haven't actually really evolved that much. But the computer in the car has evolved a great deal. So if you push out from 2030 to 2060 maybe, and you go sort of a little farther future, and you think, okay, well, over the 100-year span, what's going to change? I would predict that most of the change will be around feeding and protecting us from the environment. And increasing our ability to use technology in ways to experience things that today we do corporeally with our bodies. And I think that that's good because I think we won't be able to go outside very often in sort of motion.
Yeah, agree. And if we think about one of the changes we might see is that when when you drive from San Francisco down to Los Angeles, you see all those massive cow farms. And that's something we might not see anymore in the future, that the idea of raising cattle for livestock, for food, or like just imprisoning millions and billions of animals for food might become a thing of the past, especially with biotechnology, like Ryan mentioned, that we can be much, much more efficient about sustaining everyone on the planet, and we don't have to go to those means that will, in the future, probably seem barbaric to us.
I'd say that the most interesting thing about our time and place in the arc in the story of humanity is that we are increasingly able to program our existence. And so if we think back to when we created the printing press, let's say we were in this room and the question was, all right, now we can make the means of producing ideas broadly accessible. What kind of books do we think are going to be written? Right? Who could we ever have imagined the amount of the literature that would come out, the things people would express in writing? And if we then fast forward and we say, hey, now we can organize zeros and ones, and we can program software, what kind of things do you think we're going to build? And the same thing goes for synthetic biology. If we could actually program biological systems, what could we produce? And the same thing is genetics, same thing is neural code. And so if you take the same model and you apply it to all of our technologies, you know, we try to imagine 2030 and 2040 and 2050, but really, we bump up against the limits of our imagination because you distribute this platform to creators and we have no idea, right? We have general approximations, but it's why it's so exciting that we live in this time and age that throughout history, every other age has been limited to be subject to their environment. Whereas today, we can increasingly program our environment. So the only limitation are the tools we have and our imaginations, which will amplify. So I think it's what gets me out of the morning, gets me jumping out of bed in the morning. It's unbelievably exciting we live in this time and age.
I agree, although our resources are very constrained, right? So the planet, I always say, like people talk about hardware and software, we being the hardware and the software being the programming, but there's a platform challenge. So one thing I think is really interesting, in this whole conversation, no one has mentioned interstellar space travel.
I was right. About ready to kind of chime in. So
yeah,
no, I actually agree with you. So I actually, as the next step, I don't think interstellar is where I'd look solar system wide, right? So So when we're looking at like platforms, right, we have a ton of resources just in our solar system, things that we can reach today. I think it's great we've had a reemergence of the space industries, but they alone are not going to get us there. Right? We're going to need ways to keep our brains active. We're going to need ways of programming our biology to become resistant to cosmic radiation, to damage. If you get diagnosed with a cancer en route to the furthest reaches of the solar system to go and check out Europa, you know, and maybe start drilling in and see what's in there, you know, how are you going to treat that? You can't go to a doctor's. You have to have something that basically an intelligent system that picks it up, diagnoses it, and treats it just like it would an infection. Just take these tabs, you're done. Right? So it's a melding of all these technologies that will open up the solar system as a platform for us for exploration.
I think that 100 years from now, what's going to be really interesting is what does human consciousness look like? And what does our mental and emotional state and processing look like? And I think you're right. I think that, you know, we are limited by our imagination of what that could be. I'd be really curious to see if we will change so much that, because currently we're a very story-driven species, and we actually are very, we long to be with one another, and we long to connect. And if you think about a lot of the things that we do that are that show up in different ways, the way that we are tribal and the way that we are not tribal, and the way that you feel when you truly deeply connect with another human being, when we are able to supplement, amplify our minds and our consciousness, I think we're going to see some people who choose to have a group consciousness. We're going to see people who do it individually and then do it together. It's going to be really interesting to see how our emotions change. I'm really interested in us having new problems. And by what I mean by that is, you know, currently our base level problems are around stress, anxiety, fear, anger, and I don't think any of that will go away. I'm very interested in the freedom that comes from being able to manage those states and having emotional regulation. And so that's what I'm solving today. So I would love 100 years from now us having to, you know, deal with things like how do you manage a talk show where someone's like, how do you manage how much time you spend in solo consciousness versus group consciousness? Like, that would be, I would love to watch that show.
We've been talking about all these hopeful things that we want to build for the future and that we're looking forward to. But we also need to keep in mind that there are risks along the way, and there are things we need to keep in mind. And one thing I'm seeing is a divergence between Silicon Valley that is benefiting from all the technologies that we're building and big parts of the world that feel like they're losing out on this future. And if this divergence goes bigger and bigger, we will see a greater and greater backlash. And then the risk is even facing by our own humanity and by our fellow citizens and people in the world, if they feel like they're not taking part in this revolution, if they feel like they're on the losing side of it, we will see lots of conflict coming up in the world. And we're already seeing the first starts of these kinds of conflicts. And with automation and more efficient technologies, we will have less work to be divided up between everyone. And we will need to think of how do we build an economy that works with those paradigms, because the economy we have right now is built on the paradigm that humans need to sell most of their living lifetime in order to sustain their own lives and have a happy life. If they cannot sell their time anymore because there's no one who wants to buy it, what are we going to do? How are we going to change that? So we also, as we in Silicon Valley and very invested in technology, we need to keep this perspective in mind that we make sure that everyone else isn't losing out from this revolution.
So it's interesting. I think a lot about this. It's. I've been talking a lot lately about how the 20th century was the century of industrialization, which is the constant quest for efficacy and efficiency, and it pays no attention to the sort of larger systems engineering. It's just everything faster, better, cheaper. And I think and I hope that the 21st century is about design thinking, which is starting from thinking about the entire system and architecting a system. And one of the things we here in the Valley have actually really failed to do is to architect a system which is inclusive of everyone, And that includes political views. You know, people talk about diversity, they talk about gender, race, creed. No one talks about political view. And so I come from a family from the Midwest, and my entire family, with maybe two or three exceptions, voted for Donald Trump, and it was a vote of anger. But what's interesting about that is that's because we didn't include them in our plan, because they weren't faster, better, cheaper, and more efficient. They were kind of a drag on the system. And so we have to start to think about the fact that the drag is part of the system, not a weight part. Right.
I'd like to know what the panel thinks about the future of parenting. Mm. Very specifically, how, why, and when people are going to decide to have children, and how the role of babies and small children is going to change in our society.
Good question.
Let's keep them short so we can get a lot of questions coming.
So I'll chime in with a controversial view. So I believe we should GMO our entire world, right? Like, including us. And we've seen the beginning of that, right? So it's actually you're currently not allowed to engineer embryos in the US. It's actually outlawed. In China, it's not. Ethically, they come from a very different position. They're like, actually, we think it's okay to engineer embryos. So I think that we're gonna see increasingly a separation between ethical worldviews in different cultures on how we build ourselves, how we reprogram ourselves. And that can be all sorts of things from, you know, removing disease genes, which most of us probably agree is a good thing, to, you know, am I going to be more athletic, more intelligent? Am I going to have some bugs in the system so that I'm dyslexic, but maybe I can think about things differently? Now it starts to get controversial, right? Like, at what point are we no longer us? I support it. I just think we need to figure out where we're going, you know, and try and figure out something that's fair and ethical for every type of intelligence that evolves out. I'm a vegan, so for me, I actually still view it as like there's a host of injustices still in our world that other sentients experience, not us, not humans, not H. sapiens, but everyone else, right? So all of the others that are enslaved, what happens when we have different minds that are evolved, right? We have to be very aware of that and how we treat other living beings. So, but yeah, I think we will be engineered as well.
I think a lot of it has to do with the link with our lifespans. And as our lifespans get longer, people are going to wait till later. I think marriage is going to really evolve as a concept because, you know, if you're living 300 years, that means you could have a 100-year marriage. And so that will really, that's really going to change how people do family planning and what they think about, like, when they have kids.
The laughter in the room might indicate something about that.
So I think I'm going to take a slightly different view. So I have two children, and I think a really interesting thing I've been thinking about a lot this week, actually, is how community and family are very differently defined today. So I happened to be at a thing called Summit at Sea last week after the election, which at first I was like, oh my God, I'm trapped on a cruise boat. I can't like think about all these problems. I have all these things to do. And thank God I didn't do any of the things I was going to do the first day after the election and instead had time to process. But actually I was on a boat with 2,000 people who I view as an extended part of my family and community. And I think 30 years ago, 30 years from now, 100 years from now, I think our definitions of family and community are going to evolve. We're currently in this sort of, when you think about any evolution, you go through these waves, and we're currently at a sort of negative state of community. I think in many ways, we've broken away from family, we've broken away from church, we've broken away from a lot of these structures that felt very restraining, but we're very lonely, which leads us to be sort of, you know, very depressive. But I think that we will begin, and we have to, as a society, come together, and that will actually create new family units. So if you live for 300 years, your children's relationships will be much more matrix and lattice than they were 100 years ago.
I would build on that. I would frame it. The answer to your question would be, throughout history, societies have chosen certain value systems to live by. So they say, we build families in a nucleus family, we share the responsibility, but there's been cycle times for how long those values have stayed within the community. So we can speak now as a group about socially acceptable ways to talk about this, which things that wouldn't be acceptable in generations past or future generations. I think the key thing is that the world has a velocity of change at this point that far exceeds what we've experienced in the past, that typically follow these generational spans. But I think the rate of technological change is going to force the cycle time to go faster. So we're going to have to update our software and our brains at the same speed. And that will be contemplating what do kids mean. But the problem with the kids is like they run a really long lifespan, right? So you have them. So I have three children. And so it's not something that just changes midstream, right? You raise them to a point of maturity. And so I think that what will be interesting is how fast our mental models can iterate with the speed of societal and technological change and the conflict it creates within that. Because I think we'll have so many competing forces, it's very hard to imagine what it's going to be like 30, 40 years from now because those inputs are just unknown.
And our kids will be in charge.
All right, one more from the audience.
So 2030 is a mere three election cycles away, which is...
The elephant is still in the room.
It's really, really soon. And we've heard about programming our food, programming our minds, but what about programming our government? How do we do something there?
I thought this might come up.
So first of all, I want to say that we have a debate on specifically this topic. I think it's a fourth debate, and we will involve new forms of government. It will also talk about the blockchain. So stay tuned for that, because then we have a whole other panel of experts to talk about this. I agree with the sentiment of the question, so that we are going to face immense challenges in government too, because right now everything is based on that we have a growth of the GDP by a few percent, which may not be the case anymore. We might gain more and more efficiency, but the growth might be in different ways. Do we even want to measure GDP anymore? Is that a useful measure or not? And world leaders face really tough questions because, this global conversation has to shift to a new model, and it's... all I can say for now, it's a immense challenge. I don't want to say, this model of government is superior to all others, but we need to also stay involved in that conversation.
Let's just hope molecular manufacturing takes at least 4 years.
My biggest fear is actually the rise of transnationalism. So the amount of nationalism we see in the world is unprecedented. And it's different than 1920s and 1930s, although the analogs are very, very similar. You have a rate of massive economic growth, you have a very wealthy class, very wealthy, literate intelligentsia, and you have a very poor, rural, machine-focused people. And we are, as a society, we got to figure out how to bridge that gap and bring everyone together, or we are going to have civil war, and not just in this country, but globally.
Okay. So, can I answer one more thing real quick on this topic? So, real quickly, I went to, 4 years ago, I sold Braintree, my company Braintree, and I asked myself the single thing I could work on at that moment that would be the highest impact to society. And my answer was to rewrite the operating system of governance, right? Our collective ability to cooperate and answer these really big questions. And my observation was that I thought a revolution was coming, that the systems basically got to a point of paralysis, which was constraining the system and creating frustration that was, and so the hypothesis was that big change happens in small moments, like exogenous shock. So we've had a couple of big ones in the U.S. We've had the Civil War, the Great Depression, that the financial crisis was one, the 9/11, where these moments happen, and then this little window opens up, and this massive change gets introduced, and then it closes up, and that sticks. And then it happens again until there's exogenous shock. Now, there is gradual change that happens. You can make that argument as well. There are two competing theories. But my hypothesis was that in 2012, we were heading towards this revolution, and an exogenous shock would happen, opening a window, and I wanted to create the platform for the theoretical revolution of an operating system of governance. So if it did open up, we'd have stuff to reference. And so anyways, I worked on some stuff, a story for a different day, but it turned out my intuitions were right in some form or fact, if you consider Trump to be an exogenous shock, right, to the system.
I would agree with that.
Right, and so I mean, there's two things you could say about Trump. One is that Trump is going to be an exogenous shock that will wreak enormous damage across the world, right? In what could potentially happen with his leadership styles. We could also say that Trump would potentially be the most benign exogenous shock we could have. Enough shock to the system to say open up the window for change, but then not as costly potentially as like a civil war or the Great Depression. And so it's yet to be seen what's gonna happen, but I think you can spin these things both ways in terms of the potential window that's opened up for change of contemplating the next iteration of governance we need, right, as we contemplate the technological progress that are happening, which will just change the equation for everyone globally.
Change is always opportunity.
So, all right, we have time for one question left.
Yeah, the average income of Trump voters was higher than the average income of Hillary voters. The exit polls are really showing this was primarily social, not economic, and we have to address the social issues if we want to have these nice things.
Okay.
The thing that I would add, one of the things that I really, that was really clear, I think, in this election across the board is just the level of fear. I actually call Facebook Fearbook right now. And I have a, I don't have an echo chamber on my Facebook because I grew up in the South, I've lived all over the world, and I deliberately did not defriend around that. And so just the level of fear, what it did is it really tied me back, it really deepened my connection to the work that I do, because we have to descale fear, because if we don't do that, then we actually don't get to have the discussions that we need to have about the branch that's coming in humanity, Homo sapien or Homo whatever it is. We don't get to talk about space and a variety of other things. And so that, I think, is the my clear takeaway. And so that's where you have to have technology that supports mental and emotional well-being. It is an input, not an output. We don't use the tech to get to the better world. And mental and emotional well-being. We have to have that in the equation or we don't get there.
Absolutely agree with that. And I think one thing that might be a difference between Hillary voters and Trump voters is how they feel about the future. And I think in order to have a productive society, we need to have some kind of hope about the future. Because if you feel that everything is just going to get worse all the time and there's no hope for the future left, you might as well blow it all up and vote for Trump. But if, so one of the things we want to do is show a hopeful path and see like these are the nice things that we could have and there is a plausible path to them.
So we're at time. I will ask each of the panelists to sum up their thoughts, lessons, things you want to communicate to this audience and give us that piece of hope. Give us that one thing that you're optimistic for, so we can leave with a little bit more of a positive note.
Yeah, I think that, you know, chiming on this fear thing, the world is getting safer and safer. Fewer people are dying at the hands of other human beings. Less people are starving. There's fewer wars. Like, I am optimistic. It's just that our brains, the way that they're wired, we see something that causes fear, and we focus on that. So I think that the world is getting better. I think that's the general message.
I also feel that people are getting more active now. After the Trump election, when I was on Facebook, I saw one call for action after another, and even talking to people, a lot were, they were disengaged before, and they didn't really care, but now they really care, and they want to get engaged. And I think, you know, all the nice things that we have are made by humans. Everything is getting done by humans. So if my hope is that people in the room here, people like you and I, if we can get together and be productive and care about the future, then we also have the power to build a positive one.
There has never been a better time to train your mind. Like, this is the moment to access your inner Jedi. If you do not have a practice, get one. This is the moment to do it, because we have to, in order to be what the future requires us to be, we have to train our minds. And I'm incredibly excited because I see so many people wanting that now. People who were sort of musing about it before are now like, I am going to get a practice together. And so the world is better. The great news is that fear isn't a mandate. It is possible to affect one's fear response through mind training. And so that's what's got me inspired, that people are really doing that.
I think for me, I used the red pill, blue pill joke before, but it's really, as a society and as a people, we've had this moment, this moment of change. And we have a lot of choices, but I hope that one of the choices we'll make is to embrace the other. And the other could be the other point of view, the other society, the other belief system, or just someone who's different than us. Because I think that is, that little tiny step is the step that makes us as a people a better people and will make us great. And I'm very optimistic, actually. I see that everywhere right now. I don't see battles. I see a little bit of action, but there's actually a lot more attempts to understanding. And that gives me great hope for our society.
Yeah, I would say there's never been a better time to be alive. I mean, it's unbelievably exciting to be alive right now. And I think when people look back in history and they look at our age, when we came of age, and the things that we got to do, I think if we put ourselves in that frame, I don't like the things that happen in the world that breed conflict and when we have outcomes that we disagree about, but in the grand scheme of things, this is the kind of friction that I think we can expect. Like, we are a society that is changing very rapidly, and that messes with people's identity and their emotions, and it stresses all out, right? Like, we're experiencing new things as humans, which we can't expect to just all get along. Like, this is expected along the process. And so, in the larger frame, I understand the world. I feel so lucky that every day I get to wake up and work on stuff that really could have a significant influence on the future of the human race. And it's an enormous opportunity we have. So I'm very excited about it.
Well, thank you all. I actually feel more optimistic for my future. So thank you for that. You can talk to the speakers informally as we move on to the next section. But thank you so much for engaging. And Allison and cheers.
Thank you. Thank you so much to the panel. Thanks a lot.